So, warm welcome to the 33rd lecture on the subject of digital signal processing and its applications. We had begun a discussion on realization in the last few lectures, and in the previous lecture, we had also begun the specific theme of design of lattice structures. We had also motivated the reason for the lattice structure design. The lattice structure is important because it is, of course, a uniformly repeated structure. But more importantly, it gives some insights into the stability or otherwise of a system when the parameters are calculated. And while the direct form or the cascade forms also have their own modularity, the lattice structure has some interesting properties that we shall now slowly develop. The lattice structure takes a while to understand. It is a little difficult to understand for the beginner. So, it is worth reviewing a few ideas before we go further, even though that might be some amount of repetition. So, let us look at a few ideas that we have discussed in the previous lecture once again briefly, so that we put our discussion in perspective. We had said that we would take a typical stage of the following form in the lattice structure. We said we take the mth stage, and what I am drawing here is a signal flow graph just for the mth stage. And the overall FIR lattice appeared like this. There was essentially an input point, we will call it E0 and E0 tilde if you like. You had the first stage. And then you have the mths. For the first stage output, you would have E1 tilde and E1. At the mth stage output, you would have En tilde and En itself. And this can, of course, continue. This is the nth stage, this is how the nth stage looks. And this is all n stages together. Now, what we have tried to do in the previous lecture was to obtain a recursive relation between the system function from E0 or E0 tilde equivalently to En and En tilde, and the recursion was on the system function itself. That means we expressed the system function at the n plus 1 stage in terms of the system function at the nth stage. That was what we did last time. And the motivation for doing that is to see certain properties that evolve in all these system functions. So, what we had seen in the previous lecture was that if we took the nth stage system function, AMZ defined by EMZ divided by E0Z and AN tilde Z defined by EN tilde Z divided by E0Z. Then the recursion on the system function is as follows. A n plus 1 z is a n z plus z inverse k n plus 1 a n tilde z, and a n plus 1 tilde z is z inverse k n plus, I'm sorry, z inverse a n z let's write that down let's rewrite this a n plus 1 tilde z is z inverse a n tilde z plus k n plus 1 a n z. Now what we saw is that if we take the basis step here, then a 1 z is a 0 z, which is 1 of course, plus z inverse k n plus 1 a 0 tilde z, and a 1 tilde z is z inverse a 0 tilde z plus, yeah, so of course n plus 1 is equal to 1 here. So k 1 a 0 z, and of course a 0 z is equal to a 0 tilde z obviously, which is equal to 1, and therefore we have a 1 z is simply 1 plus k 1 z inverse. We had seen most of this the last time. And a 1 tilde z is z inverse plus k 1. And therefore, we observe that a 1 tilde z is z inverse a 1 z inverse, which is easily verified because z inverse a 1 z inverse is essentially z inverse 1 plus k 1 z, which is indeed k 1 plus z inverse, which is a 1 tilde z. So we have verified that essentially there is a reversal of the order of coefficients. The coefficients in order of powers of z inverse are 1 and k 1 in a 1 z. And in a 1 tilde they are k 1 and 1. So essentially we are saying that the order of the coefficients in terms of powers of z inverse reverses when you go from an to an tilde, and we want to prove this by mathematical induction. Now we had of course gone through the details of that mathematical induction in the previous lecture. I shan't go through all of it again, but we'll just look at a few points to put our discussion in perspective, because this is a very important topic and perhaps requires multiple attempts to comprehend completely. Yes. So what we saw then was that the inductive step could be carried out as follows. Noting that a n plus 1 z is a n z plus k n plus 1 z inverse a n tilde z, and a n plus 1 tilde z is z inverse a n tilde z plus k n plus 1 a n z. And making the inductive assumption a n tilde z is z raised to the power minus n a n z inverse. Now, what is this inductive assumption? This inductive assumption essentially is saying that you can obtain the coefficients of a n tilde by writing the coefficients of a n in reverse order in terms of powers of their inverse. This is a mathematical way of saying this. Towards the end of the previous lecture, we also explained why this is a mathematical way of saying that essentially you are reversing the order of the coefficients when you go from an to an tilde. So, making this inductive assumption and then using the two recursive steps, we can then prove an plus 1 tilde z is z to the power minus n plus 1 a n plus 1 z inverse, which means that by inductive proof the coefficients of powers of z inverse are in reverse, are in opposite orders or reverse orders between a n and a n tilde. We prove this. Now, the reason why we prove this is because if you know a n, you should be able to write down a n tilde by a very clear algorithm, and here we have a very clear algorithm. Once you know a n tilde is known. Now, what we want to do next is to realize an FIR function. So, suppose we are given an arbitrary FIR function hz, hfirz. Now, we shall assume without loss of generality that z to the power of 0 has a coefficient of 1. I'll explain why it is without loss of generality. You see, suppose for example, you have the following system function which violates this requirement. So, suppose hfirz is of the form z to the power minus 3 plus a1 z to the power minus 4 plus a2 z to the power minus 5 plus a3 z to the power minus 6. I can always extract z to the power minus 3 common from here. and write 1 plus a1 z inverse plus a2 z to the power minus 2 plus a3 z to the power minus 3. And this is to be then taken. Take this, and this essentially 3 delays in cascade z to the power minus 3. So it means you have 3 stages of that lattice where all the k's are 0. You see, you can always write this, the first 3 steps as z inverse with 0 k's, you see, you do not need to put the k's at all. You see? You can always put a cascade of 3 delays. In fact, I do not even need to leave any blanks in between. So, this realizes z to the power minus 3. So, you can realize a few delays separately, and the rest of it is then realized using the lattice structure. In any case, the lattice structure is meant for giving insights into the part of the system function which we cannot obviously see. What we can obviously see does not require to be used in the lattice structure. So it is the rest of it, the 1 plus, you know, this part is what we are interested in after all. We are trying to see what properties this part has. 1 plus a1 z inverse plus a2 z to the power minus 2 plus a3. It is this part which is of interest. So and that part can be realized with the lattice structure. What is anyway trivial can be put separately. Yes. So now the next step is to obtain what is called a synthesis recursion. You see, what we did so far was an analysis recursion. Analysis means you are moving forward from a0 to a1 to a2 to a3, that is analysis. So, you understand how to build a certain an. But now we want to build the other way. You see, you are given the kn's and you want to build an an, that is analysis. You are given the final an and you want to build the kn's, that is synthesis. So, you want to construct a lattice structure that realizes a certain system function, that is synthesis. Which means you are at the end now. So, let us assume, now it is very clear that every time you add one lattice stage, you are increasing the degree of an and an tilde by 1. In fact, that is very easy to see. Let us go back to the expression. You see, if you look at it, in the recursive step, it is very clear that a1 and a1 tilde of course have a degree 1. So, what happens to a, suppose we will assume that an and an tilde have a degree n. I do not need to write down this proof, I am just going over it orally. So, you see, let us assume by the inductive step, by the inductive assumption that an and an tilde have a degree n. Now, this has a degree n, this has a degree n, multiplying by z inverse makes it degree n plus 1. So, you have a, this sum would be of degree n plus 1. So, by inductive assumption, by inductive step, this has a degree n plus 1. Similarly, this has a degree n, so this would have a degree n plus 1. And degree n plus 1 plus degree n would give you degree n plus 1. And therefore, both an plus 1 and an plus 1 tilde are going to be of degree n plus 1. That is quite clear. What is also clear is that the leading coefficient, that means the coefficient of z to the power of 0 in the coefficient of z to the power 0 in an is 1. Now, we can see that again from the basis step. In the basis step, a1 has a coefficient of 1 for z to the power 0. So, let us assume the inductive step that an has for its leading coefficient, that means the coefficient of z to the power of 0 equal to 1. Now, of course, you will notice that this term does not contribute any z to the power of 0 at all, because there is a z inverse multiplying it. So, all the terms have at least a power of 1 in z inverse, and therefore, the contribution to the z to the power 0 term comes only from this. So, therefore, the z to the power 0 term is carried as it is from an to an plus 1. And therefore, the z to the power of 0 term is 1 always in all the an's. Now, as a consequence, it is very interesting to see that if you look at the coefficient of z to the power of n minus, z to the power minus n plus 1, the highest power of z, or z inverse rather. So, if you look at the highest power of z inverse in a n plus 1, what would it be? You see, now, you see, it is very simple. In a n plus 1 tilde, the leading term is k n plus 1, because this has no contribution to the constant term. The constant term comes only from here, and the constant term is 1 in a n z, and therefore, it is going to be k n plus 1 in a n plus 1 tilde z. So, in a n plus 1 tilde z, the constant term is k n plus 1. Now, if the constant term is k n plus 1 in a n plus 1 tilde z, then the highest power of z inverse will carry the coefficient k n plus 1 here, because the coefficients are in reverse order. You see, the coefficients of a n plus 1 and a n plus 1 tilde are in reverse order. So, the constant term in a n plus 1 tilde is the term carrying z to the power minus n plus 1, or the highest power of z inverse in a n plus 1. Now, what is the constant term in a n plus 1 tilde? This has no contribution to the constant term. So, it is only this which has a contribution to the constant term, and the constant term here is the constant term here multiplied by k n plus 1, and the constant term here is 1. And therefore, the constant term in a n plus 1 tilde is k n plus 1. And therefore, the term or the coefficient associated with the highest power of z inverse in a n plus 1 is k n plus 1. Is that clear to everybody? Let us write down. This is a very important observation that we have made. So, we have just proved z to the power of 0 carries a coefficient of 1 in a n z for all z, for all n. Z to the power minus n carries coefficient k n in a n z. So, in fact, at the end of the synthesis, that means, suppose you indeed have ensured that the leading coefficient, that is the power, the z to the power of 0 carries the coefficient 1, then the coefficient associated with the highest power of z inverse is automatically the last lattice coefficient. So, at least one part of the job is done for you. Now, there is one thing that we have to keep in mind here. You see, when we go backwards, what we will need to do is to express a n and a n tilde in terms of a n plus 1 and a n plus 1 tilde. So, we would need k n plus 1 to be known. So far, you know, actually k n plus 1 is a part of the synthesis. Now, let us be clear. See, all this while we have assumed that we knew the k n, And knowing the kn's, we are calculating the an's. Now we are going the other way. We know the last of the an's. We know the final system function. We want to obtain the kn's which realize that system function. So we have to begin with the last one, not the first, right? So let's do that. Let's begin with the last. So in the synthesis recursion, we begin with the last stage. Sir? Yes.
The last an will give us the system function.
So the question is, would the last an give us the system function? Yes, indeed. So the question is, what happens to last an tilde? The last an tilde is an auxiliary function that we are going to obtain for some other purpose. So what we are going to do is, we are going to use the an explicitly and we are going to use an tilde implicitly in a recursion for some other reason. So it's an auxiliary quantity which we are getting for some other work, right? We begin with the last stage. So we assume that H FIR Z is equal to A N Z, and N is of course equal to the degree of H FIR. That's obvious. Now incidentally, again that issue about loss of generality, see in this again we have perhaps, you know, not so justifiably assumed the coefficient of this to be 1. But even if it is not, you know, suppose the coefficient is a0 here, you can always extract the a0 here and divide everything by a0. That's not really a problem. So even if this coefficient is not 1, you can always extract it common. So it is indeed without loss of generality that we can take HFIR to have the coefficient of z to the power 0 equal to 1. And in that case, the degree of the two, the degree n is equal to the degree of this FIR system function. And therefore, Kn is simply the coefficient of z raised to the power minus n in Amz, which we know very well. Now, this is essentially what we call the basis step in the synthesis, because we have to begin with something. So here we have a basis, the synthesis begins knowing the kn, and now we have to obtain kn minus 1, kn minus 2, right down to k1, right? So we need to go one step backward. So we need a backward recursion.